Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. Food studies students at NYU vie for a spot in Meryl Rosofsky's course, Food, Culture, and Identity in New Orleans. Perhaps that's because of the field trip included in the program, an annual week of cultural immersion in the Crescent City. We'll talk with Meryl and her students about why this trip is such a game changer for so many of them. Then, we celebrate the opening of another game changer, the Goldring Center for Culinary Medicine, with Executive Director Dr. Tim Harlan. And you don't want to miss my cooking class with Kyan Douglas of Queer Eye for the Straight Guy. We're studying food from every angle on this week's Louisiana Eats. Using food as a way to understand the world is something your parents never dreamed about studying in college. But food studies has become a popular discipline in many prestigious schools. Within the past several years, Meryl Rosofsky graduated from NYU's food studies program and went on to teach in the department. Her favorite course? Food, Culture, and Identity in New Orleans.
I came out of the womb loving food. I started cooking at a very young age. I was a Francophile and, in fact, lobbied my parents long and hard to move our family to New Orleans because I knew it was a French city with great food. I was not successful in lobbying them, but I did cook. I did think and read and obsess about food throughout my childhood and young adult life. Many years later, I was already working professionally and took some time off to go to Italy for a year. I was at a crossroads in my life. So I was studying regional Italian food. I was working with chefs and winemakers and olive oil makers. So I returned to New York and learned about the food studies master's program at New York University and felt like I was coming home, like I had finally found the place where all of my passions came together in an academic context. I enrolled in the master's program, really wanting it to take my lifelong love of food, this passion, and help me make it an academic and a professional pursuit. So really getting my master's in food studies at NYU was a way to have a seat at this big, glorious, abundant food table in a more meaningful way.
Meryl brings her students on an annual trip to New Orleans so they can immerse themselves in the city's unique culture. For the students, it's a rite of passage. But for Meryl, the city's cultural significance has taken on new meaning in the shadow of crisis.
The course had been offered through the food studies program a number of years ago before Katrina because New Orleans has always been a rich nexus of course, different cultures whose foods mingle into the proverbial gumbo pot. In 2006, one of the professors in the food studies program was planning to bring a group of students down when Katrina hit. And she and others at NYU were wondering whether it still made sense to bring students down. People down here implored NYU to keep the class on the schedule. They said, "We still need people to come down here to boost our morale and, as I put it, really to bear witness." So thankfully, the course did take place that year. Being down here 6 months after Katrina was one of the most profound life-changing experiences, not only of my academic life, but I would say my adult life overall. Experiencing firsthand a city whose inhabitants were so fiercely devoted to this place, who had such a strong sense of community in place, that they were not only willing but fiercely determined to come back here against major obstacles to rebuild and reconnect with people and a culture and a food That meant so much to them. It was just very impressive. There are so few places, I think, in this country that have the soul and the heartbeat that New Orleans has. And I was just very moved and profoundly affected by the devotion people had to this place. And I wanted to keep coming back here myself to become an ambassador for New Orleans, because I think it's so special and so important and still needs and deserves to be on the radar screen and supported and celebrated and enjoyed.
You've been doing this for several years now. So how long are you here with the students?
We are down here for 1 week, which is not nearly enough. But as the students will tell you, they're very action-packed days, because I want to expose them to as many of the amazing people, places, foods, and experiences as possible. We happily overlap almost every year with some of your important cultural and food traditions, like St. Patrick's Day. So we paraded alongside the downtown Irish Club's parade. So not everything has an explicit food focus, but appreciating the contributions of so many different ethnic and immigrant and forced migrant groups to the city and how that informs the food and the culture. A few years ago, this course down here was much more about the food culture per se, so understanding Creole versus Cajun and the influences and confluences of African Americans, Caribbean, Sicilian, Irish, Native American, and so forth, as they all mingle or don't in the cuisine and in daily life. Over time, and I think very much in response to the urgencies, challenges, and in a weird way, the opportunities laid bare by Katrina, and more recently by the BP oil spill disaster, there has been a lot of grassroots activity around improving food access and addressing questions of social justice through food. Part of this taps into a national social food movement and the phenomenon of people embracing and really looking for more local foods, more seasonal foods, more sustainable food. So it's been very interesting and exciting being able to share with my students the myriad of things New Orleanians are spearheading here at both the grassroots and more institutional level to bring questions of food access and food justice together with a celebration of what's special and delicious and defining about food in New Orleans per se.
What have you seen be the resulting impact on your students from this trip?
One of the reasons I feel so strongly about teaching this class, why I'm so very passionate about it, is that there's no place in the world, to me, quite like New Orleans, that it represents everything that food studies is about, that commingling and identification with different cultures, the economic aspects, the historic aspects, and where food is so defining, where it makes up people's identity and relationships. But my real goal, my purpose in exposing them to this, is to mint more ambassadors to New Orleans. And I'm really so pleased and happy to say that that has happened. And several students on this trip are already planning to do research projects down here, to job hunt down here, to hopefully make a life in New Orleans. I've had numerous students tell me that this course, Food, Culture, and Identity in New Orleans, was one of the most important experiences they've had, and that they can't wait to come back to New Orleans.
Well, we can't wait for you to come back either. So, Meryl, please don't come back to New Orleans without coming back to talk with us on Louisiana Eats. Is that a deal?
That is such a deal. I would be honored to. Thank you.
Thank you, Meryl. Meryl Rosofsky, Adjunct Professor of Nutrition, Food Studies, and Public Health at NYU. After completing NYU's food studies program, Meryl Rosofsky's students pursue a wide range of professional careers in the ever-expanding world of food. They become community organizers, journalists, food policy experts, and often work in public health. During their week in New Orleans, Meryl goes to great lengths to connect them with the authentic Louisiana experience as seen through the eyes of locals. We caught up with Meryl and her students at Dooky Chase restaurant to hear how their view of Louisiana had changed during the visit here.
I would say I had a very stereotypical movie, media sensationalized vision of Louisiana, of New Orleans, as somewhat of a backward port city, very Bourbon Street, drunkenness.
Another misconception that I had is that the South in general perhaps wasn't as, say, cosmopolitan as the Northeast, or a much slower pace of life, and it really explodes the myth of the South being sort of
another common misconception, this is recently pop culture relevant, that we don't have kale here. There's in fact a lot of kale. There's farro, there are fields of kale, in fact, at the Grodat youth farm.
I guess one of the common misconceptions is that this place hasn't rebounded from Katrina yet, and that it should basically be lost to what happened, and that it's never going to become a great food city again, that its heyday is over.
I want to meet more local people and really experience New Orleans the way that people here experience it and understand to a greater extent why they love it so much and why they never want to leave.
Passion and pride are things that are really hard to translate on a page and even in a documentary, but just the way people's faces light up when they talk about the food or they talk about their work, and the hope that they have for this city, I think it's really infectious
to
see people.
And it's funny because in New York, so often we talk about food innovation. And one of the things that I love about New Orleans is that it's kept its food culture, and frankly, that people make that food in their homes. It's not something that you have to go to a restaurant to get.
I would say you can't get the smells, the flavors. You can't get the taste of New Orleans in a book. You can try chomping on the pages, but it's not going to do the trick.
I think that it's one of the few places in the United States that people still have a connection to food that's missing in a lot of other places.
I've been really overwhelmingly inspired by some of the nonprofit work and education work around food and farming, the people that we met at Grodat and Holly Grove, and just a lot of the farmers and educators that we're meeting, especially those who are working with students, are things that I think should be shipped out nationally and would work really well in a lot of cities.
I was surprised but also really inspired going to the veggie farm in New Orleans East yesterday to understand really how the community came out of adversity. It just gives me a lot of hope, because a lot of times when things like that happen, things go sour. They go the other way.
I almost hesitate to say this. The thing that surprised me most, I think, occurred on a trip to Antoine's in the heart of New Orleans. And for as much as progress as there has been in the way of race relations, we visited a part of the restaurant where we saw photographs, portraits of all of the Rex Kings and Queens. And it struck me that there were so many white faces, and that's all well and fine, that's good, but I think we've come to a point in time where it's also surprising that it should be just so many white faces. I think I was surprised to find that that hadn't occurred yet within the carnival culture.
I've been really inspired by a few of the women that I've met here and spoken with, and so maybe not the takeaway that I expected, but I actually have sort of a renewed faith in feminism and women being powerful and sort of shaping their societies and contributing in a host of different ways. I mean, from Leah Chase to some of the farmers and educators we met.
I don't know that it surprises me so much, but I'm so glad to see a resilience with everyone that we've talked to. People are very optimistic about the future of New Orleans and about their role in it. And I think that that speaks to a really strong sense of community and a strong sense of culture. And it's wonderful. And that emanates from everyone that we talk to. And everybody's just glad for us to be here experiencing it.
I want to bring back a greater sense of New Orleans pride, because I feel like nationally there's still kind of a narrative of looking down after what happened after Katrina, and everyone's just so concerned about New Orleans. And yes, the city is still struggling, but it's very important to relay the message that there's so much hope.
It's been a really positive experience here. Everybody has got a smile on their face all the time. Everybody's happy. Everybody's welcoming and warm. And as a jaded New Yorker, sometimes you kind of need that. And so I kind of want to go home and like be able to smile and say hi to my neighbors.
It's my plan to get through grad school as quickly as possible and move right back to New Orleans. So any future employers listening to this, let me know.
This is my first trip here, certainly won't be my last. And though we have the benefit of being here for a week is far too little to get a real feel for the city inside and out. There's still so much to explore. And we've had a great variety of experiences, but there are still so many yet to be had, and they'll be had on future trips.
NYU students from Meryl Rosofsky's class, Food, Culture, and Identity in New Orleans. When we come back, we head into the kitchen with Kyan Douglas of Queer Eye for the Straight Guy and stir up some taste memories of his beloved mom, Judy. Stay tuned. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. How often have you found yourself throwing out leftovers because you just don't know what to do with them? For native New Orleanian and food writer Scott Gold, finding a way to make a meal with those uneaten scraps represents a creative challenge. Here, Scott tells us about his love of kimchi and the brilliance of leftovers.
When I was standing in the Hong Kong market in Gretna, a magical place filled with magical ingredients, I really didn't think a 64-ounce jar of spicy kimchi was all that much. I mean, I love kimchi. It has vegetables, which I'm told are good for you, and the lacto-fermentation process it goes through makes it filled with probiotics, which I am also told are good for you. Plus, it's delicious and spicy, and as we all know, delicious, spicy things are good for you as well. Not that I have any peer-reviewed scientific studies on that particular phenomenon, but come on, you know in your heart that it's true. As it turns out, 64 ounces is a lot of kimchi. I've been working my way through that jar for weeks, and it's only now looking like I made a dent. Part of me, I'm sure, will be very proud when I dig out that last savory, spicy bit of Napa cabbage and pop it into my mouth. Maybe a bit wistful, too. But still, when it dawned on me that it was going to take some effort to make my way through this jar, I had to figure out clever ways to incorporate more kimchi into my diet. A great way of making progress on my kimchi project came one afternoon when I looked in the refrigerator and found food, but nothing really cohesive to eat. Just bits and bobs of leftovers from the past several nights of cooking. On seeing a few cups of leftover purple Peruvian rice, I got an idea. I decided there, on the spot, to cook Korean bokeumbap, or kimchi fried rice. Once I had my plan in place, it was all pretty simple. Cut up an onion, some garlic, and a cup of my kimchi, and sauté them in a skillet with a bit of soy sauce and a little oil. Then add the rice, some leftover chopped ham, mix it all together and simmer, then, the most important part of the process, top off my bowl of bokeumbap with some diced scallions and a perfectly fried egg. So, there it was. I got rid of some leftover vegetables and rice, and made one more dent in that giant jar of fermented cabbage. Not to mention the fact that it was both delicious and nutritious. I enjoy playing around with leftovers. There's not a lot of pressure to make everything perfect because, face it, you were probably going to throw some of that stuff out eventually, right? So gather up all those bits and bobs taking up valuable space in your refrigerator and get creative, I say. And if you botch the job, just realize that you live in Louisiana and there are about 7 million restaurants that would be happy to take your order. Seriously, what do you have to lose?
That was food writer Scott Gold. To learn more about kimchi and Scott's obsession with fried eggs, check out his Food Porn Fridays column found each week at nolavie.com.
Hey guys, I'm Kyan Douglas. You may know me from the television show Queer Eye for the Straight Guy and the Rachel Ray Show, but today I'm here with my good friend Poppy, and she's doing me a big favor. We're cooking up my mom's mac and cheese and pork chops, and it was one of my favorite meals that she made, and Poppy is going to help me recreate it, so I'm super thankful and super excited.
That's the sound you want.
The reason I wanted to sit down with Poppy is because I lost my mom a year and a half ago, and I miss her. And she taught me a little bit about how to make the mac and cheese, but I never really learned how to do the pork chops.
Salted side down.
Okay.
Salt is going to draw a little bit of the moisture out of the meat.
Okay.
And that is going to help build up what chefs refer to as the fonds, F-O-N-D-S.
The fonds.
Uh-huh.
From the time when she was a new wife trying to figure out how to cook for her husband, to the time that she was a mother of two and wanted to make the holidays special, that, you know, the food that she cooked and the way she put a meal together was her way of expressing love.
And I'm starting to smell that smell. You know, when you're a kid, you're all over the place. You're in this room, in that room, you're watching TV, you're playing games, you're outside, you're running all around. But when mom would start cooking, she never really had to call us to dinner because those smells would sort of waft out through the house or outside, and all of a sudden, like that smell right there, that pork, that is such a good smell.
But what I remember most was that period of time when I was a little boy and she was still sort of doing the Southern comfort food thing. It's not like it's the best thing she ever cooked or was, you know, at the top of her game when she was making mac and cheese and pork chops. She went on to do much more interesting and creative cooking. But for me, those were just the meals that I had when I was in school and I was growing up. So the mac and cheese and pork chops is just sort of a standard Judy comfort food, you know, Wednesday night meal in the middle of the week. And I loved it.
Yeah, no, if you added water to your mom's pork chops at this point, you would end up with some gray, odd-looking meat.
Well, you know where I'm getting the water bit is because my dad, and bless his heart, he said, well, she didn't put oil in there or anything. I think she just put water.
And it just brings back memories. I can remember just sitting in my mom and dad's dining room, this big wooden table. It was a pine wooden table that they had their entire marriage, and just sitting there at that table and being with my family and the security and the love of family. It's amazing that all of those memories can just pop back into your mind, you know, just because of a crunch and a taste.
Yeah, okay, I remember that now.
And what we're going to be doing is a technique that is called deglazing.
Okay.
And what you're going to be deglazing are those little brown built-up pieces on the pan, which is where all of that delicious pork chop flavor is.
Okay. You know, if my mother was here right now, I'm sure she would be saying, duh.
She was funny. She was quick, but she was kind. She was always concerned that whoever was around was comfortable, that they had what they needed, that they were taken care of. And she was a saucy little character, too. I mean, she liked to have a cocktail. Sometimes she swore a little bit. But she was just a good woman, a good, fun woman.
Honestly, Poppy, it's such a real gift. So you put a little pressure with a spatula to get them on there, to get them seared.
I want to make sure that they're on that hot skillet and they're really getting as much of a brown surface as possible. And then, of course, we're going to need a clean plate to remove them to. So go in the cabinet and grab me a clean plate. Okay, well, here comes the big test. Pour a little gravy on that. Pork chop's looking a little dry because we poured off the gravy.
So can I just give it a go?
Give it a go.
Oh my word.
Does it taste like home?
It tastes exactly like my mother's pork chops.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Poppy.
Oh, I'm so tickled by that.
Wow, so good.
Journalist and public radio contributor Ann McNulty is always hunting down a new, obscure, but delicious spot for rambling and for dining. So, Ian, where are we going today?
Well, Poppy, we're back up on the Cajun Prairie today. We're going to the town of Washington, Louisiana, and we're going to a restaurant that is a little more upscale than the places that we usually discuss here on your show. Now, as soon as I say upscale, asterisk that. This is upscale compared to Boudin stops and crawfish boiling points. I'm talking about the Steamboat Warehouse restaurant, which is probably the culinary landmark of Washington, Louisiana. And what a neat town this is. The history of this restaurant and this town are closely related. Washington, of course, is this old town right on the bayou that was originally this big bustling port back in the days of the steamboat era, right? And you can see that in this antebellum architecture that's there. And now it's famous for all these antique shops that kind of line the street. And the Steamboat Warehouse restaurant is right there on the bayou, and it's in a old steamboat warehouse from back from the old days. They say it was built in the early 1800s. So we're talking about a very old structure. There evidently were once warehouses like this lining the banks of the bayou. This is the last one left. And it almost looks like an old country barn that you'd see in France. You know, it's all brick. It's tiled, steep roof. On the inside, it's all this ancient cypress and just covered with all of this memorabilia and pictures and artifacts of the steamboat era and the town and just, you know, the country life out there. So very interesting spot. Every time I go in there, it feels like a party is on. People come in, I know, from as far as Alexandria, Lafayette. I mean, heck, I came in from New Orleans to go there. But the bar is always bustling. People are there having a good time. Big tables, lots of big groups and tables there. And what I like about this restaurant is very few things in the menu would seem like out of the ordinary to most people who are used to eating around Louisiana, but they do it really, really well. The seafood here is always excellent, particularly the pan-fried soft-shell crab that they do. Beyond like the broiled seafood and the fried seafood, the chef here actually gets in pompano, tile fish sometimes. I've seen trigger fish on the specials. But some of the more standards there are dishes like shrimp Betsy, which is almost like a barbecue shrimp dish. And one of my favorites are called side saddle angels. Now, these are shrimp that have been stuffed with oysters, wrapped in bacon, fried with a remoulade sauce. But you can get broiled seafood. And another kind of dish they hang their hat on is the eggplant bell rose, which are fried eggplant medallions with the crab and the shrimp stuffing. And then, you know, stuffed jalapeno peppers. This sounds like a bar snack, right?
Yeah.
But here, it's just, you know, crab and shrimp inside of a jalapeno pepper fried up. Delicious. And you can taste the crab. You can taste the shrimp. That's the difference.
That's delicious.
Yeah. I also like the roasted quail if you're getting just a little bit away from the seafood there.
Is it lunch and dinner?
It's dinner only throughout the week, Tuesday through Saturday, but on Sunday it serves lunch only. The restaurant is right there on the banks of the bayou, Bayou Coeur d'Alene, and it has a little deck overlooking it. So even if you have to wait for a table, and on Friday, Saturday night, you probably will, you take your drink, you go outside, you look at the bayou, you look at the trees overhanging it, you talk to some people, extremely friendly, everybody there, and you think about those side saddle angel oyster stuffed bacon wrapped shrimp you're about to have.
I'll be thinking about those the whole way there. So thank you so much for letting us in on this new place.
Always a pleasure, Poppy.
Louisiana Eats rambling reporter Ian McNulty. mentioned roasted quail, my thoughts immediately strayed to quail eggs. You don't usually find American home cooks using quail eggs, and most people may not have even seen one outside of a sushi restaurant. But here in Louisiana, we don't eat like average Americans. Jars of spicy, delicious pickled quail eggs can be found in gas stations and at boat docks all across South Louisiana. Now, here's some fun facts about quail eggs. They taste very similar to chicken eggs, but are only a fifth as large. Their small size makes them perfect for bite-sized hors d'oeuvres or to top any dish that needs just a little bit of egginess. You can find fresh quail eggs at farmers markets and specialty food stores. Asian groceries have quail eggs in a can, but I always keep a jar of those Cajun pickled eggs in my pantry for an instant elegant treat. It's super easy to cut them in half and transform them into teeny tiny deviled eggs. If you're really putting on the dog, top each deviled egg with a little bit of shoe-pick caviar. That'll get you some rave reviews. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. What's the difference between a cherry, a grape, or a pear tomato? Stay tuned, and we'll demystify that sweet, tiny fruit as soon as we come back. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Here's this week's culinary quiz question brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. Thought to have originated in Peru, cherry tomatoes have been cultivated in the U.S. since the early 1800s. They're usually red, but they can range in color from bright yellow to orange to a deep burgundy brown. And although they vary in size, they're always round in shape. Grape tomatoes are oval and come in a wide variety of color as well. Their water content is lower, are usually less sweet, and have thicker skins. Pear or teardrop tomatoes are said to have been developed in Europe in the 1700s, but my favorite tiny tomato is the Santorini cherry. With the arid conditions on that Greek island, the flavors are intensely concentrated and simply incredible. They look like tiny little pumpkins with deep ridges and usually have a bright orange-red color. Although I first tasted them in Santorini, local farmer Tony Accardo grows his own amazing version of these little beauties. Tomato, tomato, just pass them my way, please. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. It's taken 4 years for the Goldring Center for Culinary Medicine to go from a chat amongst colleagues to an innovative facility in New Orleans. Executives at Tulane Medical School initially wanted a kitchen where their students could learn how to cook, but their ambitions quickly gained momentum. Johnson & Wales Culinary School developed a curriculum and a professional culinary educator was hired. Before long, the entire community was invited to participate in regular classes. Dr. Gourmet's here to let us know how he expects this to impact the community.
In the last 2 years, we have spent a lot of time in a small kitchen downtown on the medical student campus building curriculum. We've built a course for our first and second year medical students where we basically connect that first 2 years of what they're learning in medical school about physiology and biochemistry and metabolism. And we use food and cooking as the touchstone to help them understand the dialogue and the discussion that they can have with their patients in the exam room about food. Not about nutrition, not about monounsaturated fats or complex carbohydrates, because, I mean, you don't make a shopping list that says, oh, you know, one bottle monounsaturated fat, you know, one can complex carbohydrates, 1 pound lean protein.
No.
You know, you make a shopping list that says olive oil and red beans. And so we've developed that curriculum, and then our med students have been amazing. They've been the force multiplier for teaching the community how to cook. We've done all of that as outreach in the last 2 years at places like Keller Library and Ashe Community Center and the Fertel Clinic. It's amazing response. We've taught about 1,000 people over the course of the last 2 years. We'll bring all that in-house now. And so we're going to be running, we are running community cooking classes, not quite every day of the week, but almost every day of the week. And our goal is that by June 30th of 2015, you'll be able to take a cooking class with us every single day.
And who's eligible to take these classes?
Anybody. We have a 6-module series, and we're developing a second 6-module intermediate series. So we've got this beginner series, and by the end of the summer, we'll have this intermediate series built. You'll be able to take 12 cooking classes, but then we're going to do a lot of specialty cooking classes over the course of the next year for celiac disease and people with certain conditions, gastroesophageal reflux disease, you know, people who have acid reflux. So we'll be doing a lot of specialty cooking classes like that for the community as well.
Well, it sounds like a lot of delicious prescriptions that are going to be handed out right there on North Broad.
I love that, Poppy, a delicious prescription. I think that's been the most gratifying thing for all of us. The medical students have been amazing. My colleagues at Tulane, the other physicians at Tulane, have been really supportive. Many are involved in this programming. They've helped write the curriculum. They've had input. They're helping teach classes. You know, to be able to take some ownership of this problem that we have with helping patients understand how to stop eating highly processed, you know, food, and do what you and I love to do, which is go back into the kitchen, learn how to cook for yourself, learn how to read a recipe, understand that recipe, build yourself a weekly menu, go to the grocery store with your shopping list, cook, come home, cook for to make sure you've got leftovers so you don't have to cook every night of the week. Those are the types of principles that are in our courseware.
Well, you are really inspiring me. I got to ask you one last question. What is your biggest thrill from this? What's your biggest takeaway? The moment when you went, oh, yes.
So in addition to the medical student and the community curriculum, we have started teaching the pediatric residents.
Oh.
And so we're teaching practicing physicians, and we're developing a program for the family medicine residents as well. And we have been doing culinary continuing medical education. We've developed a 12-module series for practicing physicians. So any of you out there, any of you physicians out there who are listening to this, you can go to culinarymedicine.org. You want to come to New Orleans? Of course you want to come to New Orleans.
Of course they do.
For like Voodoo Fest weekend. Voodoo Fest weekend, we'll be offering CME. You come, you spend the morning with us. We do your continuing medical education. You get something new and unique that you can take back to your patients. Then the physicians become the force multiplier. And then you go to Voodoo Fest in the evening. So that's really exciting for us. And the most gratifying thing is that our curriculum that we've built, and we've spent 2 years really building something we're very proud of, we have already licensed that curriculum to 2 medical schools in Texas.
Wow. Who?
North Texas University and UT Southwestern. And the neat thing is it's a consortium between those 2 schools and Texas Christian University, the dietetics program at TCU. And the 3 of them are teaching this at the Moncrief Cancer Institute, where they have a teaching kitchen. We have, I would say, about a dozen other medical schools around the country that are interested in, and I believe will be using our curriculum over the course of the next 2 years. And we're all going to collaborate together, and that's really the gratifying thing, that it's scalable and it's transferable, that we've created something that other people are going to use. They're going to collaborate with us. We're going to learn from them. They're going to learn from us. But it all starts here in the food capital of the United States.
Thank you so much for telling us this story. And next time we're on North Broad.
That's great, Poppy. Great to be with you.
You too. Internist Dr. Tim Harlan, the executive director of the Gold Ring Center for Culinary Medicine. The Gold Ring Center is just one of the many places offering cooking classes of all types in Louisiana. At Baton Rouge's Louisiana Culinary Institute, you can hone your cooking skills while exploring the possibility of a professional career in restaurant kitchens. In fact, pastry chef and instructor Alex Hammond highly recommends it.
Well, when you go to culinary school, you're focusing. You get a lot of information in a very short period of time. From my perspective, when I was a student, the reason I went is because I needed to jump ahead. You know, I wanted to get a running start at it. Time was, when you wanted to go into the cooking world, you started off on the lowest rung possible and worked your way up, you know, working in one kitchen for one chef for a great part of your career, you know, and it would take you a long, long time to climb to the point where you yourself were in charge or you were the chef or the owner. And these days, you know, there's a lot of competition out there for good jobs. And so, you know, when it comes to trying to get into this business, getting that head start is what it's all about. We have students in class for 16 months, and it's very, very intensive. They get it in a big hurry, and they can get out there and start working.
And it's really fun, too.
Yeah. Plus, there's a lot of camaraderie. You meet a lot of people. And another benefit to going to school is you get to work with different teachers. I mean, everybody has a different style, different skill set. Whereas if you were just working for one chef for 5 or 10 years, you may learn what that one chef knows very well, but you only learn what that one chef knows.
Describe for our listeners exactly what students can expect at the Louisiana Culinary Institute.
Well, I come to this from a more of a pastry and baking point of view because that's what I teach there. But when they come in the door, all of them start off with the basics, sanitation and things like that. We offer an associate's program there, so they're going to get some general ed, pretty simple stuff, I think. But from a culinary standpoint, they're going to get everything from basic baking, things like that, and work them up into more complex things. And each class basically is meant to continue on or build on what they've had before. By the time they get done, they're going to be walking out of there with a pretty comprehensive bunch of skills in their pocket. So they're going to be ended up working with chocolate, sugar, all that stuff.
But they're actually two different courses of study, right? Savory and pastry?
Some do both. Every once in a while you get somebody that wants to do both. There was a time when they kind of just took one program that had a little bit of pastry mixed in with it. But now they're two completely separate programs. But some people do take them both.
And that pastry program standalone is sort of unique in culinary schools, right?
Yeah, there are some around, but they're a little bit further and far between than just cooking, because I think that the thinking is that there's a lot more jobs out there for just cooks rather than pastry chefs. So there aren't as many schools out there for just pastry. So we're a little bit more of a rarity, I guess. I mean, you have to be creative to be successful in this business, because it does take a lot of dedication, a lot of hard work. And I think the payoff in all this is ultimately being able to create things that you wanted to create. Those are the kind of people that tend to migrate to our school.
Tell me, if someone is entertaining the idea of maybe going into a culinary career, is there a way that they can test the waters without becoming a full-time student?
Well, I would suggest that people do actually what I did, go out and get a job. I mean, there's a lot of entry-level jobs in restaurants everywhere. And it doesn't have to be, you know, a top-end place. I mean, it can just be you're walking in the door entry-level job and work it for a little while. This is a big commitment. It takes, you know, 16 months doesn't sound like that long, but it can be. There's also the financial commitment. And I think you don't want to take that on until you really know. Just work for a few months in a restaurant and see if it's for you. You know, even if it's just washing dishes, I don't care. You know, just get your foot in the door.
Yeah, get in that kitchen and see if you can take the heat.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
It shocks me. I talk to kids all the time who are entertaining this culinary career idea. And I spoke with one not too long ago who had, I think, a journalism major, and she'd been working in PR. And she suddenly had it in her head that she was going to go to culinary school. And I said, have you been in a restaurant kitchen? Have you worked? Yeah. And she hadn't. And I said, well, for goodness sake, don't spend that money until you see how you feel about the actual experience.
Yeah, you know, all the cooking shows on TV are great. I mean, it's really opened up the world of cooking to being something that draws people in and is a respectable way to make a living. But it's not just all flash and cameras and beautiful clean jackets and everybody having fun. You know, it's a tough way to make a living. So
and you
make sure
all
it's
are,
for you before you do it.
You all are a private school.
Yes.
Similar to, you know, the other big name private schools like the Culinary Institute of America, Johnson and Wales, for instance. I think that it's really great for people to know that they don't have to go that far away for this kind of quality education.
Exactly. I mean, we're local. Our price point is actually a great deal lower than those two schools. I don't know exactly where we are because I'm not the money guy, but you get it when you come to LCI. So, you know, we're local if you want to stay local. And, you know, if you're from far away, coming to Louisiana isn't a bad deal when it comes to cooking. So, because we give them the Louisiana flavor on everything, too.
And what about the leisure classes that you all offer there?
Well, they tend to be weekend, but they don't have to be weekend. There's a few during the week as well. It's for people of all sorts. Some just want to come in and take a quick class, learn how to do something that they've maybe never done before. We get a lot of younger people in there who maybe are taking a class or two to sort of see if maybe going into a full-time program would be a good move for them. We get groups in there. We get families in there who take a whole class together. And it can be anything. It could be baking bread. It can be doing Cajun food. It could be learning how to use your chef knife. We do everything there. It's kind of a chance for the instructors to kind of play a little bit and do whatever they want to do.
Well, I want to thank you so much for taking the time out to visit with us on Louisiana Eats.
That's been fun. Thank you very much.
Chef Alex Hammond of the Louisiana Culinary Institute. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Next week, we'll celebrate St. Patrick's Day with the Pattersons of Finn McCool's.
The entire time that we've owned Finn's, we have the weest parade in the world. We have a king and queen. We have St. Patrick and St. Bridget. We have a leprechaun. We have floats made out of cardboard that people step into. And we parade from the front door to the side door, and it's over.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Bacardi USA and Dicky Brennan and Company. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to our producer, Chris Kehoe, associate producers, Joe Schreiner and Sarah Holtz. I'm Poppy Tooker. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.